Are you being able to see slide number 43 on your screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So we were doing this fiducia metathesis algorithm, and we had problems in understanding this. Hence, I'm just going through this algorithm again. So it's a heuristic algorithm which starts with an initial partition randomly generated. So it's a partitioning algorithm. Think that we have something to partition based on some cost function. First think generally, then we will come to exactly what we are doing. Based on some cost function, we have to partition it. Now, if I have a cost function, then that cost function comes through the partition by the tasks having by the tasks being on one side or the other. You have a cost of the partition corresponding to that partition. And let us say, and you also understand, not let us say, also understand that if I move the task from one partition to the other partition, the cost of the partition changes because obviously I have moved. And for example, okay, but I had created one small example. It's not a, I did not get a lot of time, so it's not a very good example, but I'll try to tell what I mean. So don't take this. This is just for space. So let us say I have a task graph like this.
So your voice is not coming.
Yeah, I'm just drawing once. I'll quickly finish drawing. Are you being able to hear now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right. Yes. Okay. So this is the task graph that I have. Okay. So I have a task graph like I had for ACC also. I have a task graph like this. And see, I have changed the problem a bit. I have made the problem opposite. That I have a task graph of a controller, and what I want is to minimize the time which the controller takes to execute, subject to the fact that I cannot have the hardware area cannot be more than a certain value, let us say A. This is also a valid proposition, that I have a fixed hardware area. Because hardware is costly, the amount of functionality that I will put in hardware is limited, and it is limited by a capital. This total hardware chip area that I have is A. Within that, I'll push functionalities. And likewise, for each task, I have a hardware cost HI and a software cost SI. And let us also say that my software costs are very less. All my software costs are one. Because you understand that I have just cooked up this example. So to explain you a situation where you were stuck yesterday, in which you said that why would we take a negative gain? Okay, so that is the problem we are trying to. So A, B, and let us say currently my partition is this. I start with an initial partition. This is my partition. Is my partition, and let us say this is hardware and this is software. Also, see that I have costs on the edges. B to C 12, B to D 20, B to A is 40, D to E is 28, E to F is 14, and C to F is 2. So these are my communication costs. But that means that if one of these tasks are in hardware and the other task is in software, then I incur a cost. I incur this cost. Sorry. I have made a mistake. Just a minute. How did this become so big? Oh, I just see this one. Difficult to understand what happens. I took a pen now. Oh. You know how to solve this, how to make this again small? This.
Sir, you have to just click on the square above the currently selected.
I have to click on the square, this one.
The red square, yeah, just above. Yes. Now we should try editing the thing.
Oh. Just a minute. Ah, thank you. It has come back. Right. So my partition is this. So A, B, and C are on one side of the partition, and D, E, and F are on other side of the partition. And let us say A, B, and C are in software, and the other D, E, and F are in hardware currently. Okay. So now see that if I move any of the tasks. So what I am doing fiducia matrices, I will come again to the algorithm. But see, the basic thing that we discussed yesterday is that I take one of the tasks and move it to the other side. And which task do I take? The one which provides me the highest gain. And now my problem is to minimize the total software execution time subject to the fact that I have a constant, means the area has to be less than something. Forget about the constant for the time being. Just see that I will try to find out the task which provides me the highest gain. That means my gain now is the highest reduction in software execution cost, and I will select that task and move to the other side. This is what my fiducia matrices algorithm tells me. Now let us consider each of these tasks. If I move A to the other side, I will increase the cost by 40. Why? Because I am saying that it is a very communication dominated task graph, and a lot of data needs to be transferred. And hence, if I move A to the other side, then I will increase. And I am just saying I am neglecting the 1-1 values. Why? Because you understand why did I keep this one, so that it does not come into our consideration. So the actual computation cost on the software is just one. So that is not the problem here at all. The problem is communication. Now, if I move A to the other side, I will increase the cost by 40. So my gain is negative. Gain is negative 40 because now I want to minimize. If I move D on the other side, if I move D to the other side, I will gain by 20, but I will lose by 28. So my effective loss is 8. If I move E to the other side, then my loss will be high. 28 plus 14 will be my loss. If I move F to the other side, my loss will be 14 minus 2. If I move C to the other side, my loss will be 12 minus 2. Are you with me when I have set up to this? If I move B to the other side, my loss will be 14 plus 12 minus 20. Right? So, the point what I'm trying to make here is that everything you move to the other side, all gains are negative. If this is the current partition, and I can always have a partition, a situation like this, because I am telling, at least you can assume this fact, that I'm starting with a random partition. So initially I have to start with a partition, and I can very well have a situation where the current partition is of this sort. There is nothing in the algorithm that stops me to have a situation like this. And I have a situation in which if I take any of the tasks and move to the other side, I am at a loss, negative gain. But the point here is this: if I move, let us say, if I still move D, and who is giving me the lowest loss? Who is giving me the lowest loss at this point in time? I think it is D. I think it is D which is giving me the lowest loss, because the loss is only 8. If I move any other task, the loss is higher than 8. You see? Am I correct? So if I move D to the other side, because I said that I will move to the other side, which task? The one which provides the highest gain or the lowest loss, right? The highest gain could be the lowest loss if everybody is negative. So now when I move D to the other side, then I again have a situation in which I have many positive gains. I can move E to the other side as well and then get a huge gain. So ultimately I can have a situation in which D is moved to the other side, E is moved to the other side, possibly C is moved to the other side. And then I have on one side, I have B, A, D, E, and in software, and on hardware, I have C and F. And that possibly may give me the highest gain. And why am I putting it onto the other side? Let us say I did not give you the constraint on balance, which is sort of that area constraint I have. The area must be more than the hardware area must be more than this and less than this. Now, when I put A into something, I must have some of these tasks in hardware and some of these tasks in hardware. I cannot get away by saying that I will put everything in software. That I cannot have. I will have to have something in hardware because of the balance. Let us say I have to have some things in hardware, but not more than A. And that is my lower bound and upper bound. And hence, I will try to get the highest gain, keeping that balance into perspective. And from that perspective, I will see that I have a situation in which if I don't take this negative gain at this time, I cannot get the positive gain later. I understand it is not a very good example. I did not get a lot of time to create a nice example, but I think it solves your problem. The confusion that you had, I think that is solved through this. Is it solved partially, or you have a question? You can ask me. Then we will go back to the algorithm and try to understand again. What I'm trying to impress upon, that I may need to take a negative gain to allow a good positive gain afterwards. Hello.
Yes, sir, that part is clear, but another question I am having, the gains you are writing, the costs you are writing on the edges. So how are we getting those values? Means in the earlier algorithm, we have simply one HI and one SI, but here means every vertex is related to.
I got your point. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Audible. See, we said that for this problem, we are solving this problem where I have a task graph. That can always be solved. That problem I solved over there because branch and bound can be applied to any problem. Branch and bound could be applied to this problem as well with a task graph. But I did it with the independent task set to explain you with a problem that I can handle within my PowerPoint slide set. So I simplified the problem by saying that I only have a set of independent tasks with no communication cost. Now because this is a heuristic, it is easier for me to handle a more realistic case. By the way, it is not that branch and bound cannot be solved for that realistic case. I can also show you how you can apply that for precedence constraint task graphs. And it is just a small extension, not big. However, let us come to this case. The problem we are solving here in this heuristic is that I have tasks which are precedence constrained, right? Like this. And I'm saying that what are these edges? The weights of these edges, like this 12, it tells the amount, it is the time which is taken, which is consumed for data communication between T2 and T1 if one of T2 and T1 is in software and the other is in hardware. Right? If both are in software or both are in hardware, I don't incur this cost. Why? Because this is the bus communication cost between a software processor that I have and a hardware chip that I have, right? And I'm saying that this is the very communication dominated example in which a heavy amount of data, it has to be sent from the output of one task to the input of the other task. In comparison to that, the actual execution of the code on software is negligible. But still I need to have some things in software because I need a balance between software and hardware. Cooked up example, I get it, means I take it. But I wanted to explain you this. Now do you understand why do we have these numbers on the edges? It corresponds to precedence constraints. It reflects, it is proportional, it reflects time, it directly reflects time, but it corresponds, it is proportional to the amount of data that is being transferred between B and A. So 40 is the time taken to transfer data from B to A. If B is in software and A is in hardware, say, and it reflects that a high amount of data it has to be transmitted from B to A for this. Is this okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. That's while clear. Transferring one task from software to hardware, how are you calculating that gain? Can you please repeat it?
Okay. Yeah. So see, my computation costs are very negligible, right? Everything is one. So I'm doing a rough calculation. Sorry, I should not put these circles. So what I'm saying is that these are small numbers. So I'm just throwing this out of consideration. I'm only considering the communication cost because the software execution costs are not high. Now, what I'm saying is that let us say you take this, both B and A are in, say, software. So this 40 is not in the picture right now. But now, if you take A and send it to the other side, this A will get in hardware and B is in software. So this 40 cost will be incurred because one is in hardware and the other is in software. So hence, I will have to incur a loss of 40 if I move A to the other side. This is what I'm saying. Is that okay with you?
Okay.
Now, if I take D to the other side, what is happening? I have incurred a cost of 20 because of this communication. But if I take D to the other side, now this 28 will come into the picture because E will be in hardware and D will go to the software side. So although I will get a reduction of 20, I will have to incur a cost of 28. So that is why I am saying that if I move D to the other side, I have to incur a loss of -8. Sorry, a loss of 8 and a gain of -8. Is that okay?
Yes, I got it.
So now I have a situation in which if I move any task on the other side, I will only have negatives. But I will take the lowest negative and move to the other side with the hope that by incurring this negative, possibly I may get a big positive gain later. This is what it is.
Okay. And so how is that initial partition? Is that
initial partition, this one? Initial partition is random. And then I'm saying that this initial partition can be obtained through a set of moves. either initial means I have taken a situation in which I have done a set of moves and obtained this partition. I have told how does Fiducia Mathesis start? Fiducia Mathesis algorithm starts with an initial partition created randomly which preserves balance. And then it starts by choosing the node from any one of these partitions with the highest gain and moving it to the other side, right? Such that the balance is preserved. And then it goes on doing. In between, I will have, so whenever I go move, I get a new partition, going on having new partitions. At any step, I have a current partition, and on that partition, I calculate the gains, try to find the task with the current highest gain, and move to the other side. So the situation I have shown is a particular instance at which I have done a set of moves and obtained a partition like this. To impress upon you that this partition can always come, I said that at least you will have a partition initially, so I can have this partition. So given that partition, when I run Fiducia Mathesis, I will have a situation in which I have to take the lowest negative gain. I do not have any positive gain. And then when I have taken this negative gain, later I will get good positive gains. Is this okay with you?
No. Okay.
So now let us.
One more thing. In that graph, how are you taking both a hardware area cost and communication cost?
I did not take. It was just to show you the positive and negative. It is, don't think of the other aspects of it. I have cooked up this example in 10 minutes. But I'm saying that let us say you can have a situation. It's not that you cannot have a situation. Let us say that this one represents a problem in which you are saying that the hardware area cost must be greater than A1, and if A is the actual area cost, must be greater than 1 and less than A2. You have to maintain this balance. While you are doing all partitions, you have to maintain this balance. And I'm saying that let us say even if you are moving this D, your balance is still preserved. Currently, your balance is preserved. And although I am not doing this, the Fiducia Mathesis algorithm will do it. I had not thought of this situation when I created this example. But I'm saying that you can very well have a situation in which if D is moved to the other side from, say, hardware to software, your balance is still preserved. So you can have this move of -8. You can take this move. And then you can say E cannot be moved. Say after D is moved, E cannot be moved because it will disturb the partition. But you can still move C from to the other side. And then when C is moved to the other side, possibly E can be moved to the other side. And then we get a very low cost partition where your objective is satisfied of minimizing the software cost.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, and let us go back to balance once more. Yesterday we were also talking about balance. So let us say your R value is 0.5. R is equals to 0.5. WX union Y is the total cost, total weight. So one is the cost, which I'm trying to minimize or maximize. The other is the weight, which is the constraint. So this balance is with respect to the constraint. Therefore, it has been defined with W as weight. Right. Now, and the other is cost. Now, let X union Y is some value and X is some value. So here, if we think that we are minimizing hardware area cost. Let us say X plus Y. I have six nodes. If I have six nodes, X union Y will be 6, and everybody's area is 1, and WX will be 3. So is your partition balanced at that time? And let us say S max is 1. So R is 0.5 into W is 6 minus 1 less than equals to W. Is this value less than this? So 0.5 into 6 minus 2. 2 is less than 3. So this side is okay. On the other side, 0.5 into 6 plus 1, which is 4. So that is also preserved. So currently, if I have R equals to 0.5, WX equals to 3, and WX union Y equals to X union Y equals to 6. So this is this, right? W equals to this one. Are you with me in slide number 45? Hello.
Yes.
So if this is the situation, then you understand that this your system is balanced. Your partition is balanced. Have you got the idea of balancing? Essentially, you have to fix the value of R, you have to fix the value of S max. Given that, based on your actual areas of your tasks, you will get a value of if I am talking about the problem that I just said today, I am minimizing the software cost subject to a constraint on area. The total area of the tasks in software is WX. The total area of the tasks in hardware is WX union Y. And I am trying to maintain a balance of this area in software and in hardware. To get a balance, I will use this. Okay. If this is okay and you are satisfied with this, I will go back to the algorithm now. Question? Is there a question?
Sir, what, like, how do we decide on what value of R we are supposed to choose?
That depends on the problem, right? Meaning that, that depends on the problem. What do I mean by this? When I have a hardware software partitioning problem at hand, I will have resources at my disposal based on which I will do the design. I will have a certain amount of area on hardware that I can synthesize on, and it is feasible with respect to my cost, the cost of the chip that I will design with respect to that. A minimum I can have, a maximum I can have. I'm saying that if my hardware, I am okay with it with respect to cost, with respect to design time, etc. If my hardware area is more than A1 and less than A2, I am okay with such designs. But given such a design greater than A1 and less than A2, give me that partition which minimizes my software execution time cost. If this is so, then my initial problem becomes I want to have A1 greater than this and my area greater than A1 and less than A2. Based on that, I will be able to find a value of R and a value of S max. Are you with me? And are you satisfied with the answer?
Yes, sir.
No.
I understood.
Okay. So now let us come back to the algorithm. So I start with a balanced partition. I create a random partition, but it has to be balanced. Fine, I can do that. Are you with me in slide number 44?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think there is a lag today, right? Between what I'm saying and what you are viewing. Maybe. Okay. So whatever, we have a partition, balanced partition P X comma Y, initial partition, and then I repeat these steps. So I have N nodes. I have N nodes in this inner loop. So there is an outer loop and there is an inner for loop. So outer repeat loop and an inner for loop. So let us come to the inner for loop first, this inner for loop. Okay, in this inner for loop will run for all tasks. In each round, it will run for all tasks. I have N tasks, so I will have N iterations of the for loop. In each iteration, I will find the task that gives me the highest gain in terms of reducing the partitioning cost or increasing the partitioning cost, whatever is the objective of the problem, right? That gives me the highest gain. I take that node or the lowest loss. Highest gain means lowest loss as well, as we just understood. I take it and move it to the other side. And after I move to the other side, what do I do? That should also preserve balance. I have to choose a node that preserves balance, the one that gives me the highest gain and that preserves balance. I move to the other side and lock. Lock means in further iterations of this inner loop until unlock, I will not be able to move that task again to the other side. So if I have moved, say, taken a task and moved to the other side of the partition, I'll not be able to remove it to again back to the previous side. I won't be able to do that because I have locked it to that partition. That is what lock means, until I have unlocked. And due to this move, I have gained, right? And see, because of this move, all my neighboring nodes with which I am connected, their cost will also change. And based on that, based on the number of nodes I'm connected with, my cost of the partition will change. If you see the previous example, when I move one task, I am actually moving the connections as well. So firstly, because of my movement, because of my software cost, I will change the partition cost will change. Secondly, because of whom I am connected with, my partition cost will change. So I will do that. I will update the costs of my neighbors and also the total partition cost I will change due to this move. Because if I do not do that, I will not be able to find out who is the best, who will provide the best gain in the next iteration of the inner loop. But then I will go on doing this for all the end tasks, and finally all the tasks will be moved from wherever they were to the other side. But there will be an order in which this has been done. That is important to us. After all the end tasks have been handled, then I exit the for loop and unlock all cells. So unlock all cells is done after I exit the for loop. The for loop are these three steps. This is the for loop, inner for loop. I come outside and unlock all the cells or tasks. As I told you, these are tasks. Actually, Fedusa Mathesis also is very popular for VLSI physical design partitioning, where you actually, these cells are circuits. These tasks are not tasks, but circuits. And you want to partition by saying that I will have blocks which I will partition the circuit into. Right. But forget that problem. So here I have tasks. So I am moving tasks from one side to the other. Now, after this inner loop, the movements that I had done in the inner loop were all tentative moves, not final moves. Whom I will move finally in this iteration? So I will find this. So I will find the value of K, I'll find that value of K for which G is maximized. This capital G is maximized. Now, what is capital G? Capital G will be one of these elements, as I told you yesterday, G1 or G1 plus G2 or G1 plus G2 plus G3, G1 plus G2 plus G3 plus G4. Likewise, I will calculate up to G1 plus G2 plus G3 up to Gn. But now, because I have taken negatives somewhere, one of these values will be highest. Will provide me the highest gain. Maybe G1 gives me the highest gain, or G1 plus G2 gives me the highest gain, or G1 plus G2 plus G3 gives me the highest gain, incurring the negatives in between as well. Or G1 plus G2 plus G3 dot dot up to GK gives me the highest gain. So I will find the value of K for which this G1 plus G2 dot dot up to GK is maximized, considering all n tasks. And I will actually move this K tasks, T1, T2, dot dot up to TK, those moves that I had done, those sequence of moves that I had done inside the inner loop, those will be actually moved. The other ones, that means gk plus 1 up to gn, they will not actually be moved. After I have done these moves, I have actually got a new partition. This new partition will be the initial partition for my next iteration of the loop, right? And these iterations will continue until I have a complete, these iterations are going to continue until I have a complete iteration of the inner loop for which ultimately capital G is equals to zero. I do not have any positive gain, or let us say less than equals to zero. G is less than equals to zero. I do not have any positive gain. Even if I shift one, I only get zero or no gain, means loss. So everywhere. So why is this happening? Because you see, my partition is getting refined with iterations of the inner loop, right? Now, at some point in time, my initial inner loop, initial partition is also is very good. So at that point in time, whatever movements I make to the other side, I only lose. Nobody gives me any gain because I have already got a very good partition. And whatever I do, calculate g1, g1 plus g2, g1 plus g2 plus g3, how much ever I do up to g1 plus g2 dot dot up to gn, I only lose. I do not gain at all. At that point in time, for the entire loop, I will have this capital G less than equals to zero. Understood, right?
Yes,
are
sir.
You with me? Yeah.
So just one doubt. What do you mean that it is shuffled the cells up to the kth step? We have already moved it inside the loop, right? So
right. I have moved inside. How much have I moved? I have moved for all the end tasks I have moved, right?
Yes, sir.
All the end tasks I have moved. But I said that these moves are tentative. These are only for doing the calculations. What do I want to calculate by doing those moves? I wanted to find out what is g1, what is g1 plus g2, what is g1 plus g2 plus g3. I get these values through those movements. Okay? Because yes, you understand that there will be a value of k for which g1 plus g2 dot dot up to gk will be maximized. And thereafter, I did not actually gain in the last iteration. Means effective gain, I did not get in the last iteration. Effective gain, the best effective gain I got only when I did the iteration, when I did the movements up to the kth step, up to the kth task. After that, I only effectively lost. Meaning that the best gain I got when I only did the actual movements up to the kth task. Are you with me on this?
Yes, sir.
Yes. If this is so, then I am saying that the in the previous loop where I have done those movements, those tentative movements are frozen only up to the kth step. So k plus 1th to nth, I do not actually take those movements. Although I had done those movements inside, but I don't take those movements. I only take the movements up to t1, t2, dot, dot, up to tk, for which I got the best gain for the partition.
So we reshuffle the rest of the tasks.
Reshuffle the, yes. Means so essentially
back into the X partition.
Yeah, back, because I know which task I have moved to the other side, what movements I had done, I know up to the kth task, right? Subsequent to that also I know. So whatever I have done for tasks k plus 1 to k up to n, for tasks t k plus 1 to tn, whatever I had done, I will revert that back.
Yes, sir. Got it.
Right.
Thank you.
So then I will get a partition. That will be my initial partition for my next iteration. And I will do the same set of steps again until I get a complete iteration for which I have no gain. Capital G is less than equals to zero. Fine, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, the last point here is that how do I implement this? The implementation is also nice and easy. So here I have n tasks, right? You see, I have a list of n tasks, this n. And let us say, so these are the maximum set of n tasks, and I have a data structure of size n for partition x and another data structure of size n for partition y, because the number of tasks in partition x will be less than equals to n, and the number of tasks in partition y will also be less than equals to n, because the total number of tasks is n. And I keep a sorted list. I keep a sorted list of pointers. I keep a sorted list of pointers, or a linked list of pointers, a sorted array of pointers. Let us say these are array of pointers, such that what will be the size of this list of pointers? The size of this list of pointers will be the minimum possible gain and the maximum possible gain. Let us say the minimum possible gain when you move a task to the other side is minus Pmax, and the maximum possible gain is plus Pmax. So all your gains, whatever you have, will be in between this. And at any point in time, so what is this list? This is the linked list of all tasks at a given time, which provides me a gain of a certain value of gain, say G. A certain value of gain G. This one is another certain value of gain, say G dashed. For this, you will again have a set of linked list. Right? So it contains all tasks with the same gain. So this linked list contains all tasks with a certain value of gain. Now, what is happening? So, and you have a separate variable which points to that position in the linked list which corresponds to the highest gain. So all these places are blank. There are no tasks here. There are no tasks between Pmax and this value at a given point in time, because this one is telling me that this is the maximum gain I have. So all I have to do is to find the position in which I have the cell with the highest gain, and then move it to the other side of the partition, because I have another data structure which is holding for Y. This is for partition X, and I have another one for partition Y, the same data structure. And then when I move, what I'm saying that I will change the cost of the partition. I will have a set of neighboring tasks for which this gain will change, and all my neighboring tasks which are connected to me through edges, for them the gains will change. So for them I will again change the places in the linked list, and then I will be able to I will move it to the other side. And each of these task nodes in the linked list will be connected to the tasks in the corresponding tasks in the list. Okay, so again, I think I have confused you enough, so I'll just try to tell about this data structure again once more. So what do I have? I have a linked list of tasks on each side, or this linked list could be one also. This task list could be one also. Either I have two task lists or I have only one task list, does not matter. But this part of the data structure, I have two instances.
So
hello. Hi. So this red circled, this red, actually I am trying to see what you are seeing, ma'am, and I am getting a lag. So I'm waiting till what it is coming, because I am drawing, but if you are not seeing that whatever I'm drawing or whatever I'm writing, you won't be able to understand. So what I'm trying to say is that the part of the data structure that I have circled, that I have two instances, one for X and the other for Y. However, this task list could be one also, does not matter. And what is this data structure? this data structure is an array of linked lists. It's an array of pointers, and what does each of these elements point to? It points to a linked list. So each position, so the first position, so let us say this is position 0, this is position 1, like this. So position 1 of this array of pointers points to what? Position 1 points to all tasks, to a linked list containing all tasks, which will provide a gain of 1 if moved to the other side. So this position having one, it points to a linked list of nodes of tasks, which will give me a gain of 1, which if moved to the other side of the partition. Is this okay with you? You can ask me. If you are confused, ask me. I will be able to answer. Hello.
No, sir, until this okay. Till this okay.
Till this okay, right? Okay. If till this is okay, then what happens? You just need to have a separate variable which will point to the position in this list of pointers which has the highest gain value task, right? The first non-empty pointer, non-null pointer, this max gain will point to that, because these are all null. It does not contain any task, does not point to any task. So if this is the one with the highest gain, then I will just select the first task in this list and move it to the other side, because all these tasks provide me the same gain. And then when I move to the other side, where will I move? To a similar data structure which I have for the other side, right? So this is it. No more for this algorithm. Let us stop here. Oh, already 5:56.
Now, so the first element you said it will send, because like the linked list will contain, like each node will have a task with same gain. So the first one will send to the other, right, other side.
Because I'm moving only one task, right? And then after, when I move to the other side, my software cost, means my partition cost, has changed, and there the gains of some other tasks will change. Which tasks gain will change? The tasks who are neighbors to this current task which have been moved. I have moved a task, and I am connected with edges to a set of neighbors of this task. So the gains of all those tasks can possibly change, right? No other task gains will change.
Yes, sir. Then after that, what will happen to this data structure?
So I will update the gains of those tasks and change the position of those tasks. So they may possibly go to some other linked list, right? So I will update those. They will be constant. Why? Because I can only have a constant number, means on an average, I will have just a constant number of neighbors for a given task. So I will update their positions in the linked list, and then I will do the next move again.
Okay, sir, just one more thing. Like, how is that like ending? Like when you said,
hello, I just did not get you. Once more, please. Are you hearing me?
Yes, I wanted to know, like, how is it ending? Like, at the end, you said
when the gain will be less than equals to 0, your algorithm ends. What do I mean by this statement?
Yes, sir. Like, how is it finally stopping?
Okay. See, now what I'm saying, appreciate a particular thing. That suppose I have got through an iteration, the partition that I'll get at the end of an iteration will be better or same as the partition that I will get at the beginning of that iteration. Otherwise, all my gains are negative. Are you with me on this?
Yes,
that
sir.
I start the inner loop with a partition, I end the inner loop with a changed partition. After I have got g1 plus g2 dot dot up to gk, I've changed the partition, and this partition, if I have changed, is bound to be better than the previous partition. Is it okay?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So if this is okay, then you see that when I'm going on getting more and more refined partitions, there will come a partition in which I will do not have any gain. Capital G will be less than equals to zero, because my initial partition was more, means is refined, and any sort of movement that I make inside this, the current loop, I am only lost.
Yes, I got it.
Right. So then the algorithm is stopped when I get a complete partition with no gain. But I had another algorithm to teach you, the stochastic one. But I have many other things to complete in this syllabus. So possibly I will leave it here and I will move to the next topic tomorrow. I'll try to see. I'll because I have this topic, I'll just tell this in 10 minutes. Don't try to understand it fully if I'm not able to explain. But I'll tell this quickly and I'll not ask questions if I'm not able to explain you nicely. So that's it for today. Let us stop here. And tomorrow, 8 o'clock, we meet again. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So thank you. Bye for now.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.